Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm Stuart Dambrot, your host. We're here today with Mark Wigley, architectural theorist, scholar, and author, and the Dean of the Columbia Graduate School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation. One thing that we've talked about off camera, and that it makes eminent sense in terms of the idea of social media and ubiquitous distributed intelligence and some of the other aspects of your thesis, is that of crowdsourcing.
Yeah.
And you had mentioned to me that some of the writing you're doing now is about crowdsourcing, and I would really love to ask you about that and to talk about it a little bit.
Yeah, well, I think you know, if you look at the last 5 years or so, crowdsourcing has gone from a kind of you could almost say from a kind of a marketing or a kind of exaggeration of a social media effect to a very substantial research technique. I mean, when mathematical theorems that have evaded solving for 500 years can be solved in 6 weeks. And three solutions produced by a group of around 100 mathematicians, of whom about 27 became very, very active in the crowdsourcing, and about three did the heavy lifting. You see there that that's a way of thinking. So crowdsourcing has become an extraordinary mode of thinking. And of course, if you're in my field and you're interested in the future of cities, well, you're interested in the future of the environment that incubates crowds. Like, you're interested in what it means for large numbers of people to live together. So the question, what does it mean for large numbers of people to live together, all of whom have different ideas and aspirations, and we have to think about how do you live with the other, how do you live in a dense cosmopolitan city of the future? The target of our research, the complexity of urban life, and one of the best ways to think about that, crowdsourcing, that's very much the same. In other words, we're using the crowd to think about the crowd. Now, what does this actually mean? Like, where will crowdsourcing go in my field? I'm really uncertain, but I would at least risk the thought that our field will be only as intelligent as it's able to integrate crowdsourcing into its model. And I would go one step further. I think I would demand of our field that we change the concept of crowdsourcing, because crowdsourcing still implies that there is such a thing as a crowd. And you see, there is no such thing as a crowd without a city. See, the crowd is a kind of a symptom of urban life. So when people say we're using crowdsourcing, they're saying we're using an existing concept of the city to think. Now, in my field, we don't accept the existing concept. We're interested in the next thing. So that means the next concept that goes beyond crowdsourcing. By that, I mean, of course, how can we really incubate a fully real-time collaborative ecology of kind of creative design around the question of cities. And I think we've got about 5 years to work on that.
Well, that is very interesting. It relates, I think, in some ways to a more recently emerging, not spin on, but it's differentiated from crowdsourcing, because crowdsourcing is stewarded, and then there's transmedia, which is at least theoretically not stewarded, that it arises spontaneously from the myriad participants.
Yeah.
And that might be a model that might work its way into the kind of future you're talking about as well.
Yeah, I think, well, I think, of course, if, for example, you could crowdsource the unconscious, in other words, going even one step further, what if the full complexity of our unconscious would be harnessed in a collaborative mode. Now we'd be talking.
We would.
In other words, crowdsourcing as it operates today requires the people participating to have a clear self-understanding of their role in the process. But if, of course, it's the unconscious, that is to say, all of those dimensions of our being over which we cannot claim to understand fully, and yet nevertheless structure ourselves, I mean, you know, if I could satisfy, if I have to make a beautiful city for people, and if I have to make that city satisfy their conscious or their unconscious, which is the best city? Of course, I think the best city is the one that satisfies unconsciously, even if consciously that everybody says, I hate my city, if the unconscious is being satisfied, maybe that's a better city,
right.
Which is another way of saying that it's a terrible architect that gives the client exactly what the client asks for.
Quite right. And this makes me think I have a parallel, and I'd love your quick comment on this, which would be that, of course, in cognitive psychology, cognitive neuroscience, there's a theory of mind. Mm. The ability to imagine what the other person is thinking and what that person is thinking about my thinking and, you know, meta levels of thought. It's just what you were saying just reminded me of that, except because you had the crowd thinking about the crowd.
Yeah.
Well, that's a kind of a crowd theory of mind, what the crowd is thinking about itself.
Yeah.
Because once it's a crowd, there are individuals as well as the aggregate.
Right.
Something to that effect.
Well, I don't think there is ever any idea in any one brain. The ideas are fundamentally social, and they live in the interconnections between brains. Mm-hmm. So the real brain is not, you know, carried around inside our head, but is in our combined system. And that system is very, very large and has an enormous capacity. If people say that the human brain is still a remarkable, misunderstood, extraordinary mechanism, an even more extraordinary mechanism, it seems to me, is the interconnection of all of our various brains. And again, we find ourselves, when we speak about the ecology of ideas and cities, there's really no difference of this discussion. Cities are places which ideas are incubated and move and evolve.
It's quite interesting because it brings simultaneously to mind Derrida's contextual position, mm-hmm. but it also brings to mind J.J. Gibson's quip on what is ecological psychology, mm-hmm. Which didn't quite pan out in terms of direct perception, but he did say, ask not what is inside the head, but rather what the head is inside of.
Well, it's a fact. You can only be a soloist in a crowd. You can only be an individual in a crowd, which means that there's no such thing as a real individual. That individuality is an effect of crowd behavior. So we can, and this again is how crowdsourcing is so important, because crowdsourcing accomplishes a highly condensed, almost sort of electric charge of focus, because it's a form of distributed intelligence. So paradoxical effects of distribution, of distributed intelligence, is points of intensity. New York itself is a point of hyper-intensity, but you cannot imagine New York outside of a global economy to which it's absolutely interconnected.
Quite right.
So again, when we think cities, we are thinking about the sort of interconnectivity that yields points of great density and focus.
That's very beautifully put. The final thing I'd like to ask you would be to apply what we're talking about right now to urbanization, and specifically the myriad and complex factors involved in aging populations in an urban environment in terms of planning, design, socioeconomics. And it's an open question, because I just would love to hear what you think about that issue.
Well, quite possibly it's the single biggest question we face, because, you know, if 7 billion people are living in cities by 2050, 2 billion of them are over the age of 60. That means they have a different eyeballs, different level of experience. Their body relates to space differently. They have different kinds of wisdom.
Right.
So the city that would accommodate this massive population is very different from the city of today. Also, they're a source of ideas and wisdom. And so in the current thinking of the city, we treat only those people of the working ages, like, you know, from 20 to 65, as having valid opinions about city life and urban life. We live in very segregated cities. We don't treat children or old people as intellectual companions. And one of the reasons I think the university of the future will completely disregard age in its normal way of thinking is there's enormous creativity when you combine 9-year-olds and 10-year-olds. In other words, that's the loop. And I think in the future, we will think of the productivity of our society and the intelligence of our society as dealing with a kind of transgenerational capacity. Since we have sort of segregated our knowledge economy, university students, postgraduates, doctors, professionals, and so on, because we have segregated ideas into spaces, we have greatly reduced our capacity to operate. Now, the city of the future, when life expectancy would be something like 100, all over the world, and this is one of the big factors in the explosive growth of the density of cities, cities will become highly dense, intelligent organisms, and a lot of that intelligence will be found in people over the age of 65 and less than the age of 20. You know, mm-hmm. if you want to be an internet billionaire, you're going to be 13 or 14 years old. And 90-year-olds have a desire to leave the world better than they found it, that's so strong and so creative, but we treat them as used goods. We have a kind of industrial relationship to intellectual capital. So this is directly a socioeconomic question, immediately and directly. Cities will not survive unless we find ways of looping back the gathered intelligence of the very young and the very old. And I think this is just going to happen. There's no choice.
Now that you articulated and explicated, I can not find a way to disagree. Thank you so very much.
You're welcome.